It's a scary time. We're deep in the heart of a global pandemic, and we're staring down the barrel of a major economic recession. The live entertainment industry has already been hit hard by abrupt cancellations, and it's easy to be apprehensive about the future. Even after it's safe to gather again, will theaters and concert venues be able to recover from the abrupt loss of income? Will audiences have the money to spend on non-essentials like live entertainment? Or will the economic fallout make it impossible to bounce back? In times like this, the stress and uncertainty can loom pretty large. There's no way of knowing what will happen next week, much less over the next couple of years. Even though nothing like this has happened in modern memory, this isn't the first time live entertainment has had to adapt to economic hardships. History is here to provide some insight into how we might adapt. In the past, live musical theater has not only endured the worst economic depression North America has ever seen, but came out the other side to begin a new golden age. The context may not be exactly the same, because, of course, nothing in history is a one-to-one comparison, but by being aware of how our artistic forefathers not only survived, but thrived during their time of great turmoil, we can prepare ourselves to do the same. So today, let's look at three questions. What was going on Broadway in the 1920s, before the Great Depression? How did the Great Depression affect Broadway composers, and how did those composers react? And how on earth did they manage to turn a situation as bad as the Great Friggin' Depression into the golden age of musical theater? And hell, let's do a fourth question. Where do we go from here? So, things right now also don't seem so great. Hell, let's be real, I think they kind of suck. So is there anything we can learn from the 1930s that applies to our present day situation? I think there is. In fact, I think the past can be an extremely important source of inspiration during difficult times like this. Maybe you'll agree, maybe you won't. One way or another, it's something new besides rewatching The Office for the third time, right? So, let's talk. In the 1920s, being in New York was dope as hell. Commercial theater around Times Square was booming, both on Broadway and off, with over 200 shows running at any given time. Many of those shows were musicals, which at the time meant one of two things, musical comedies or operettas. So both of these styles were typically pretty light and fluffy. Musical comedies were usually farces or romances, which emphasized popular song and dance numbers. Now, the songs were great, but had little to no bearing on the plot of the show. These songs came from a group of Tin Pan Alley composers. Tin Pan Alley was a name taken from the district where a lot of America's popular music was initially being composed and published. Operettas were pieces that borrowed from the European opera tradition and were typically from European composers who had landed in the US. They integrated music into the structure of the play in a more natural way, coming from a more legitimate opera tradition, but were still typically pretty light as far as mood and content went. As such, both musical comedies and operettas were typically regarded as not being legitimate, in contrast to plays without music. So it's really important to note that musicals at this time did not suck. A lot of the people accusing the art form of being illegitimate actually just didn't like musicals very much. A lot of the pieces written during this time were friggin' beautiful. During this time, Irving Berlin wrote some of the most popular songs of the 20th century for review shows, including What'll I Do and Blue Skies. The Student Prince by Sigmund Romberg and The Vagabond King by Rudolf Frimmel are both beautiful operettas. Cole Porter, George and Ira Gershwin, Richard Rodgers and Lawrence Hart were all writing at a very high level. Kurt Weill was doing all sorts of cool stuff in Germany regarding the marriage of music and theater. So the list goes on. We've got heavy hitter after heavy hitter composing some seriously beautiful musical theater. However, if we want to talk about bringing legitimacy to the genre, we got to talk about Jerome Kern. Jerome Kern was a composer with a passion for theater. He'd been instrumental in the development of musical comedy with playwrights Guy Bolton and P.G. Wodehouse early in the 20th century. Their shows quickly developed a reputation for having especially good music, as well as plots that actually made sense, which was a novelty at the time. By the mid-1920s, the three had stopped collaborating as frequently, and so Kern started looking for a new writing partner. Enter Oscar Hammerstein II, an upstart young lyricist with Broadway in his blood. He'd been mentoring under lyricist Otto Harbach, and a question had started to formulate in his brain.
Is there a form of musical play tucked somewhere away in the realm of possibilities which could attain the heights of grand opera and still keep sufficiently human to be entertaining?
So in 1925, Hammerstein and Kern set out adapting the novel Showboat into a musical. Now remember, this is 1925, so musicals are either musical comedies or operettas, they're farces, they're romances, so Showboat was a really bizarre choice to adapt. It's a sprawling epic, following the lives of performers, stagehands, and dock workers working on a Mississippi riverboat over the course of 40 years, from 1887 to 1927. Specifically, it centers on the life of a couple, Gaylord Ravenel and Magnolia Hawks. Racial prejudice and segregation are a big thing in Showboat. So are themes of romantic, platonic, and parental love. It also featured a few plot points which made total sense to audiences at the time, including a man drinking his mixed-race wife's blood. He does this so he will also be considered mixed-race, and thus their marriage won't be illegal in Mississippi. He drinks her blood. At one point, towards the end of Act 1, Gaylord Ravenel reveals that he once killed a man. This is met with another main character saying, "Well, in fairness, I've also killed a man." And then we move on. Gaylord Ravenel shows up 24 years after he gambled away all their money and then bailed on Magnolia and her kid, and then Magnolia takes him back. That's the happy ending. That's how the show ends. Obviously, this is a pretty big departure from the musical comedy plots of the time. That said, Hammerstein and Kern saw the potential and they set to work adapting it. The results are friggin' sick. Hammerstein condensed the plot of the book, he lightened it up, but even with all of that said, the results are way darker and way plot heavier than anything the Broadway had seen up to this point. When it comes to the score, Kern is a total rock star. His score combines the pop hit mentality of musical comedy, with songs like Can't Help Lovin' That Man of Mine, with the music as narrative strength of operetta in the opening number Cotton Blossom. Most importantly, it weaves all of that together with elements of blues and American folk music, like in Old Man River, to create a score that is intrinsically tied to the story. Past musical comedy scores were in danger of being generic, maybe even interchangeable. Showboat score, on the other hand, can never be used for anything except for Showboat. The lyrics are fantastic as well. You can already see elements of the earnest sentimentality that Hammerstein would come to be known for throughout his career. To some people, Showboat is important because it marks an especially skillful marriage of two distinct genres, operetta and musical comedy. To others, it marks the beginning of the American musical's bid for theatrical legitimacy. One way or another, it was a big ol' success at the end of the 1920s. What could possibly go wrong? A few years after the success of Showboat, something not as cool happened. In 1929, the stock market crashed, marking the start of the Great Depression. Over the course of the next 5 years, almost half of the banks in America had failed, and unemployment reached 30% of the workforce. Combined with this, the practice of unskilled overcultivation in America's Great Plains region came to a head in 1931 with a drought. The result was significant loss of agricultural income, and walls of blowing sand and dust that further destroyed crops and homesteads. This is not good. This is real bad. The president at the time, Herbert Hoover, believed that it wasn't the role of the federal government to manage a financial crisis, and as such, took a hands-off approach to the whole situation. Anyone who's familiar with Annie knows how well this went over.
Hey, Herbie, you left behind a great relation.
So Herb, our hats are off to
you. Herb, our hats are off.
We're up to here with admiration.
It wasn't until Franklin Roosevelt took office in 1932 that things started to change. By the start of the 1940s, America was finally beginning to see signs of serious recovery due to FDR's New Deal and the advent of World War II. Now, the war is generally considered a not great thing. As it turns out, it was a stimulus to America's economy. The effect of the Great Depression on Broadway was devastating. Between 1929 and 1939, Broadway saw a 42% decline in the amount of shows being produced. Over 200 in 1929 to under 100 by 1939. It was brutal. Many theaters converted from showing live performance to showing movies, which were much cheaper from a production standpoint. Many Broadway professionals fled to the West Coast to create those movies. So what did composers do in this time of crisis? Well, whether they were in Hollywood or New York, they kept right on composing. The progression from Showboat to the Golden Age of musical theater did not happen in a vacuum. It happened thanks to creators creating their asses off. So, real quick, here are my top four composers who kept on composing throughout the Great Depression.
You're the top.
You're just saying that.
You're the Swanee River.
First up, Cole Porter. He's a musical virtuoso from a young age. He goes to Yale and then Harvard. You know, the smartest guy in the room, Harvard kids that helped start SNL? Yeah, Cole Porter was one of those, but in 1910. He starts his career as a Tin Pan Alley Broadway songwriter. Things start slow for him, with middling success for about 10 years, and then things hit, and they hit hard. He writes the music for the comedy Paris, and his songs Let's Misbehave and Let's Do It become breakaway hits. People start to really key into his knack for wordplay, rhyme, and risque yet not explicit, eyebrow-waggling material. Like, for example, Let's Do It. His best show from this period, and one of his best shows full stop, is Anything Goes. It featured a young Ethel Merman and just banger after banger.
In olden days, a glimpse of stocking was looked on as something shocking, but now God knows anything goes.
As far as writing quality, witty, popular songs for musical theater, Cole Porter is undeniably the king. Kurt Weill was a composer from a classical background. He got his start writing for symphonies, operas, and theaters in Germany. In the 1920s, he collaborated with noted theater funny guy, Bertolt Brecht, on the Threepenny opera. It broke huge ground in its own right as far as merging music with legitimate theater goes, but when it found its way to Broadway, American audiences hated it, and it closed after 12 performances. At this point, Weill had fled to America because he thought the Nazis sucked. And he didn't let Threepenny's failure get him down. He collaborated with lyricist Moss Hart and Ira Gershwin on Lady in the Dark. Lady was significant in that it eschewed most of the musical comedy and opera traditions to be a true play with music, and a drama rather than a comedy. Throughout Lady, musical numbers only happen either diegetically, as in the main characters know they're singing, or inside fantasies and dreams. Kurt Weill may never have achieved the superstar songwriter status of, say, Cole Porter, but history recognizes him as an important voice in the history of musical theater. George and Ira Gershwin were brothers. Obviously. Let me paint you a word picture. George is a bomb-ass composer. He can write pop songs. He can write orchestral works. He wrote Rhapsody in Blue, which is now recognized as a big deal. He's noted across the board as one of the strongest composers of the 20th century. Ira is a writer. He's made some headway writing sophisticated humor articles for magazines. He's also writing lyrics for shows occasionally, under a pseudonym so that people don't think he's coasting on his brother's brilliance. What a mensch. Their father suggests they write shows together, after presumably rolling their eyes and going, "Dad!" They give it a try and it goes really well. Their first show, Lady Be Good, is a hit. From there, they are crushing it. Of Thee I Sing lampoons politics, but with more sophistication and less cheap gags than musical comedies of the 1920s. Porgy and Bess is even better, a tragic opera at a time when musical comedy was the order of the day. That score integrates jazz, blues, and Americana in a way Broadway hadn't seen before. You know the song Summertime? Boom, Porgy and Bess. Sadly, it doesn't last long. George dies of a brain tumor in the late 1930s, which is the only reason the Gershwins were not at the forefront of the musical theater revolution for the next 20 years. Finally, let's talk about Rodgers and Hart. Composer Richard Rodgers and lyricist Lawrence Hart formed a 22-show partnership that was extremely significant in the history of musical theater. Their musical comedies found significant success throughout the 1920s and early 1930s, where they wrote like a show a year. As the Great Depression went on, they found that work on Broadway wasn't coming as often, nor was it as lucrative as it had been, so they made their way down to Hollywood. After 3 years in Hollywood, they got tired of the studio system, and they made their way right back up to New York, where they wrote 10 more Broadway shows. Seriously, these guys were machines, and these shows weren't just throwaways either. With On Your Toes, they strived to integrate music with dance in a more significant way than had been done in musical theater in the past. Rodgers eschewed the usual dance arranger, which is an additional staff member who would typically compose dance breaks, to instead compose the dance music himself. Their show, Pal Joey, which starred a young Gene Kelly, took it even a step further, integrating dance within the action and striving to be a musical comedy that was cynical, ironic, and ended without a happy ending, or any kind of final resolution at all. Audiences were here for it, and Pal Joey was a success, making Gene Kelly a star. Finally, by the end of the 1930s, Lawrence Hart was getting pretty sick, and the duo's prolific output had slowed right down. The Theater Guild approached them about adapting the play Green Growth of Lilacs into a musical. Rodgers was in, Hart wasn't. So, with Hart's blessing, Richard Rodgers proceeded to adapt it with a new collaborator. You know who it was? It was Oscar Hammerstein II! So that brings us to... Green Grow the Lilacs originated as a play written in 1930 by Lynn Riggs. It had a small run on Broadway in 1931, but didn't find much success, closing after a couple of months. The play features many American folk songs that are performed in-world by the characters as a part of the play's action. However, it is by no definition a piece of musical theater. The Theater Guild saw further potential in the show, and they hired Rodgers and Hammerstein to adapt it into a full-scale musical. The result was Away We Go! Which was later retitled to Oklahoma! Oklahoma was Broadway's first true blockbuster, and for good reason. It continues Showboat's fight for theatrical legitimacy, and it takes the past decade of musical theater into consideration when it does so. Now, it isn't focused on being the first to innovate anything, but on assembling the past decade's innovation in the most effective way possible. The Americana of Porgy and Bess, the wit and optimism of Anything Goes, and the integration of dance from Pal Joey. Most significantly, it included the same commitment to being a dramatically sound piece of theater as Showboat did. The score employs American folk music just as much as it does Tin Pan Alley-style songwriting.
Oh, what a beautiful morning! Oh, what a beautiful day! I got a beautiful feeling! Everything's going my way!
As well, many of the song's lyrics are so well integrated into the piece that they make virtually no sense at all outside of the play.
Chicks and ducks and geese better scurry when I take you out in my Surrey. When I take you out in my Surrey with the fringe on top. Now you
watch that fringe and see how it flutters when I drive them high-stepping strutters.
Nosy pokes will peek through the shutters and their eyes will pop.
While the score is brilliant and beautiful, and while there are some songs written in the Tin Pan Alley style, most notably People Will Say We're in Love, Rodgers and Hammerstein wrote to make sure that the songs were all in service of the play, first and foremost. Unlike Showboat, however, Oklahoma's story doesn't seem out of the question to be adapted as a musical. It takes place in farm country outside a town in Oklahoma. The central storyline features Curly, a cowboy, Lori, a farm girl, and Judd, a farmhand. Curly and Lori have a Jim and Pam style flirtation going on, in that they're into each other, but can't quite seem to make it work. Judd is kind of a creep, but Lori agrees to go to a dance with him just to spite Curly. The second act takes place at the dance, where Curly wins Lori's hand and they get married. Also, Judd gets angry and tries to kill Curly, but instead falls on his own knife and dies. There's also a secondary comic subplot involving a girl named Ado Annie and a guy named Will Parker. So as you can see, the main plot is a laugh-a-minute love triangle, while the secondary plot exists to lighten any tension. Like, for example, a main character falling on his own knife and dying? What the hell, guys? Additionally, the show features big production numbers and a romantic resolution for both our A and B couples, Lori and Curly, and Will and Ado Annie. However, it also rises above the musical comedy formula. Musical comedies had gags, wisecracks, off-color humor. Oklahoma, on the other hand, has jokes that are born directly out of script situations. At the end of Act 1, Lori gets high on smelling salts, which were actually opium. Not only does she dream an extended ballet sequence to end Act 1, her dream affects the plot significantly. Also, did we mention that Judd dies on stage at the end of the show? Even the opening defies convention. Rather than starting with a rousing Jazz Age production number, Aunt Eller sits quietly on her porch as Curly sings Oh What a Beautiful Morning from offstage. Audiences were super there for it, and Oklahoma was a monster hit. The original production ran for over 2,000 performances on Broadway. Rodgers and Hammerstein continued their partnership, writing 10 more shows, most of which are considered some of the most significant and impactful shows in musical theater history. We're talking South Pacific. We're talking Carousel. We're talking The King and I. We're talking an obscure piece called The Sound of F***. f***ing music. Even more importantly, many of the elements used by Rodgers and Hammerstein in Oklahoma would go on to become tropes of the entire genre. For example, a main romantic couple, a subplot built around a humorous secondary couple, a middle-aged mother character providing advice and inspiration, the death of a main character providing significant impact in the second act, a dream or fantasy ballet, and structurally, a heavily weighted first act with a shorter second act. These elements are so ingrained in the art form that some of them may even seem cliché. They actually form the basis for many of the clichés that we find in musical theater. Rodgers and Hammerstein created the foundation for a period of artistic and financial prosperity that we now know as the golden age of musical theater. So, why was Oklahoma so successful? Maybe after a period of economic turmoil, audiences were ready for a more dramatically mature form of entertainment. Maybe, as the world entered a Second World War, audiences responded to a piece that was profoundly American, in everything from the style of its music to its very name. Maybe, as America was still reeling from the Dust Bowl epidemic that had ravaged Oklahoma, they were eager to remember the land as it had been, rather than as it was. Especially since "We Know We Belong to the Land, and the Land We Belong to is Grand" has a nicer ring to it than "And the Land We Belong to is Trying to Kill Us." So, what lessons can we draw from Oklahoma as inspiration during these trying times?
Look, the golden age of musical theater was not the result of a couple of independent geniuses creating in a vacuum. Rather, it was the result of an entire community of artists building on each other's successes. The whole thing wouldn't have even happened if it weren't for the fact that these artists and many more kept right on creating even when times got hard.
It's a scary time. I know this, you know this. Hell, every mailing list I've ever signed up for apparently knows this. We need to give ourselves time to be scared, to be angry, to be depressed, because the fact is we don't know what the future holds for the arts. This could be a time of significant change to the very fabric of live performance. However, and this is important, taking all of that into consideration, we have to recognize that this isn't a death sentence. This could be the time when we innovate methods of live performance that fully integrate a digital medium. This could be the time when our processes become fully accessible to differently abled artists and patrons. Probably many different things will be innovated from many brilliant and driven artists. We'll just have to wait and see. From the worst economic downturn America had ever seen came a revolution in musical theater that still influences the art form to this day.
Well, this is our downturn. It's time to get to work.
Thank you all so much for watching, and to everyone who made this video possible. Especially to Jill Willems for doing a ton of research, and Daphne Finlayson for editing and directing the shit out of this. If you're interested, I recommend listening to the 1993 Toronto revival cast of Showboat, conducted by Jeffrey Heward. The way his cast and orchestra interpret this score in a modern yet respectful way lets the score shine to its greatest potential. It's really something incredible. If you'd like to learn more about us, please like our page on Facebook and follow us on Instagram at Village Conservatory to hear more about what we've got going on. You can also donate to the Vic through the link in the description. Thank you all again for watching, and let us know in the comments if you'd like to see more videos like this in the future. Take care, y'all.